In my dealings on the internet, I often talked about authoritarianism. And because the word sounds very similar to authority, I was surprised to see that a lot of people don't know what it means. Authoritarianism doesn't mean a hierarchy or a structure. It means blind faith in authority. It means that power is concentrated in the hands of a few people, and questioning the actions of those people is unthinkable. It also means that the people who are in charge are never responsible for their decisions. This is what authoritarianism means. It is a system of power and control. And when a government becomes authoritarian, it starts to seep into the private life of citizens to the point where there is no more private life. Everything you do is going to be in the public domain, and everything you do is going to be the government's business. Now, obviously, it is absolutely horrible to live under such a system, but it is absolutely amazing to be in charge of such a system. And throughout history, politicians have tried to concentrate power into their hands in order to be able to social engineer society according to however they want to. Case in point, we have China. Now, China is a very authoritarian nation. And what's interesting to point out is the way they try to social engineer society. The ways of the old, where the government is directly involved in the life of the citizens, simply doesn't work. We simply cannot have the resources or technology to censor every person in society, to make sure that people think the right way. As such, an indirect measure is required. With the advancement of social media, the Chinese government now has a perfect way of controlling how people think and to try to get people to censor each other without the government having a need to intervene. It seems that this is the most reasonable way to go around the authoritarian dream, and it also seems that it is very practical. Because the previous firewall of China, where they tried to directly censor people, could be bypassed. People could find workarounds. As such, it wasn't a perfect system. But this new digital tyranny dystopia that they're creating seems to have very little workarounds. And it's a system that simply works by itself. So how does this system work exactly? Well, first you have the government making massive propaganda and talking to people about the importance of gamification of trust and how citizens need to be trustworthy and the importance of having a system where we allow the trustworthy to roam freely under heaven while making it hard for the discredited to take a single step. And obviously, the government can now just define the terms. They're very ambiguous, and they can define what it means to be a trustworthy person versus what it means to be a person that's discredited. And it seems that the purpose is to excommunicate from society people who are discredited, while give certain perks and privileges to the people who are considered to be trustworthy. Now, the government doesn't have to intervene anymore from this point forward. They simply have created the terms of service for a person to live under Chinese society. From this point forward, it is all about the social media companies that operate in China to create a system that is going to promote certain people and it's going to demote others. And this is the Chinese social media point-based system. In other words, whenever you are conforming to whatever the government wants, or if you are doing activism on behalf of the government, you're going to get points, and you're going to advance compared to other people. But if you're guilty of wrongthink, if you're going against the government, or you're saying things that are not deemed to be politically correct in China, you're going to lose points. Furthermore, what's even more interesting is that if you happen to lose a lot of points, the people who are in your friends list, the people you associate with on social media, are going to lose points as well because they are associated with you. As such, there is going to be powerful peer pressure from your friends, your family, and other people you have on social media to get you to stop doing the activities. Or if you are unwilling to, you are eventually going to become unfriended and no one is going to want to associate with you. And this system that's dubbed a digital dictatorship already has its first victim. A journalist by the name of Liu Hu, who has accused the government of corruption, has been blacklisted by the social media and was deemed to be dishonest. His rail travel was suspended, his social media accounts compromising 2 million followers were shut down, and it completely made his job impossible. No more does the Chinese government need to arrest or execute dissenters. They will simply make them invisible in the public life. They will simply make them unable to voice their concerns against the government. In an age of technology and social media, where everyone has a megaphone from their bedroom, not being able to maintain a social media presence means your voice is going to be a whisper while everyone else has a speaker. People will be unable to listen to what you have to say, and you'll also be made as an example that if other people echo your views and your ideas, they might also lose their social media presence and be ostracized. This system is tyrannical in its efficiency. And furthermore, the government doesn't even have to intervene. Its hands are clean. Now, we know that in China, social media companies are operated by the government. But if a similar system would be implemented in the West, the government doesn't have to censor anything. The government just stands by while the social media companies and private corporations do all the censoring for the government. The government just has to do subsidies and pay lip service to the social media giants and do whatever they ask. And in return, the social media giants could censor on behalf of the government. Also, NGOs, think tanks, and activists, if they would manage to influence the terms of service that social media companies operate under, they would also gain a lot of control on what is and what isn't allowed for people to think. Imagine if being pro-choice would be against the terms of service. As such, no one on social media would ever be pro-choice because they would be afraid that they would lose their account. So just controlling the terms of service means you don't have to actually control what each individual person has to say on the platform. Furthermore, payment processors and other private businesses could also influence how people think. If you don't like what a person has to say on Gab or on BitChute, simply shut down your service to them. And they won't be able to keep operating under a market where their competitors benefit from online payment processors. Now, I'm not saying that we have reached the level of Chinese-style censorship in the West and that the private companies operate under a similar point-based system like they do in China. But what I am saying is that I want people to think really hard about this. If a government like China, which could get away with pretty much any way they would want to censor the population, and out of all those ways, they have decided that this is the most efficient and the most practical way to do it, doesn't that mean that we in the West need to look at that and try to implement laws and legislation to prevent that dystopian from happening? Social media is a new invention. It did not exist in the past. And just like with the invention of the printing press, people had tried to make new laws and legislation in order to account for such an invention. For example, the law regarding intellectual property didn't exist until people could simply mass produce a book. If you have a book and that is your work, if someone could just copy it and sell that copy under the same price, you as the author would be damaged because of it. And as such, laws to protect your work were required. And I think that certain laws, like maybe an Internet Bill of Rights or some similar fashion, would also be required in order to avoid falling under a similar Chinese system. Now, I have noticed on my channel, because I constantly read the mainstream media since it's part of my job, and time again, the mainstream media in the West were criticizing and they were horrified of the Chinese point-based system. However, recently, and by recently I mean after the last 10 months, I haven't seen an article criticizing it at all. In fact, I constantly see articles from the mainstream media praising whenever someone gets deplatformed, like Alex Jones or Tommy Robinson, or anyone who gets shafted by these private companies, all I hear is praise and applause. But no one is being concerned anymore about the fact that these companies that are operating for profit are consolidating their power on the internet, and they also have political ambitions. And the interesting thing about China is that you don't really need the government. The propaganda campaign that the government is making in order to get people to not trust whomever the social media deems untrustworthy and trust the ones that social media deems trustworthy can be replaced by the mainstream media. The mainstream media can coin a term like conspiracy theorist, and anything that person says needs to be discredited. And wouldn't it be funny if also the social media and some politicians would get to define who exactly is a conspiracy theorist?
I don't want to be part of a European foreign policy.
The problem... this is a dangerous fantasy. The idea that there's going to be a European Air Force, a European army,
it's
it
proposed.
Is simply not true.
Oh,
the problem with people like Nigel Farage is they swing at
what
windmills. They see
do?
Conspiracies everywhere. I wouldn't
do?
Be surprised if Nigel Farage soon tells us that the moon landing was a
do?
Fake, that Barack Obama isn't American, that Elvis isn't dead. You know,
why
it is not...
Regarde le monde où nous vivons. L'Europe est de plus en plus fracturée. Quand je regarde le monde où nous vivons, vous avez des puissances autoritaires qui réémergent et qui se réarment aux confins de l'Europe. Mm-hmm. Nous sommes bousculés par les tentatives d'intrusion dans le cyberespace et l'intervention d'ailleurs dans notre vie démocratique de plusieurs. Nous devons nous protéger à l'égard de la Chine, de la Russie et même des États-Unis d'Amérique. Quand je vois le président Trump annoncer il y a quelques semaines le fait qu'il sorte d'un grand traité de désarmement, qui avait été pris, je le rappelle, après la crise des euromissiles, au milieu des années 80, qui avait frappé l'Europe. Qui en est la victime principale? L'Europe et sa sécurité. On ne protégera pas les Européens si on ne décide pas d'avoir une vraie armée européenne.
Wir haben große Fortschritte bei der strukturierten Zusammenarbeit im militärischen Bereich erreicht. Das ist gut und wird ja auch hier weitestgehend unterstützt. Aber wir sollten... Das sage ich sehr bewusst auch aus der Entwicklung der letzten Jahre. Wir sollten an der Vision arbeiten, eines Tages auch eine echte europäische Armee zu schaffen.